Hello, today I'm talking to somebody who since 1942 has appeared in over 60 films. Films in which he's been said to have mostly played the part of a stoic, it's taken a lot of research to find this quote, a stoic, down-to-earth nice guy, common-sense friend of the hero, and all-purpose good sport. Most of you there will probably recognise him not from his films, but as Hudson of Upstairs Downstairs, and Cowley, CI5, in The Professionals. Gordon Jackson, welcome to Imperial.
Hello, Donald.
Can I start by taking you back to your Hillhead High School days, because that's where you had your first experience in entertainment, on the radio, in fact.
Yes.
How did you manage to get onto the radio at such a young age?
Well, it was extraordinary. In Scotland in those days, this was before the war, there weren't any professional actors as such. No Scot would ever have thought of becoming an actor. So everyone had a job, and in the evenings for fun, either they did amateur dramatics, or in a strange way, they got bits on radio and BBC.
Yeah.
But they all had jobs during the day, and I had a school teacher who did exactly that.
I see.
And I happened to sort of read poetry and things in the class, and he said, oh, I'll take you along there, and there might be parts for children on children's and schools programs. And I went along and did the odd bit sort of thing, and that's how really I started.
I
but directly school was finished, I went into a drawing office and I became an engineer.
That's kind of
but my name was still in the books with the BBC, and I still did odd little bits on the side. And out of the blue, Zealing Studios got in touch with them, the BBC, and said, you know, a Scots type for a film.
Yeah.
They suggested me, and that's how I started in films.
I see, and that, of course, was the form went to France.
That's right.
In 1941. How did your fellow employees at the drawing office, how did they feel about your taking time off?
Well, it wasn't a case of taking time off. The war had started by then. I'd been at the drawing office for about a year, and I was given permission because it was a sort of propaganda film. So it was all down to sort of Whitehall and things, and I was shoved down to the studios for a few weeks. But immediately I went back to my drawing office. I never thought, this is the life for me. And then a year later, out of the blue, they suddenly wanted me for another part and another propaganda. Again, Whitehall did the trick, and down I went. No, they just took it for granted, because I settled into the drawing. They accepted the fact that I really was a draftsman. It was only after 4 or 5 years, and I'd been in 2 or 3 films. The boss of the drawing office said, come on, make up your mind. What is it going to be? It should be one or the other.
You didn't feel at the beginning, after that first film, that you still didn't feel you wanted to go into that?
Oh, no. No, as I say, no Scotsman. We're all engineers and very practical people. And the idea of saying I'm going to be an actor in those days was a joke.
Yeah. Bringing you back onto a film you did a couple of years later, in 1948, Flood Tide, which I'm sure you remember.
Yes.
I think that was your 7th film. Proved to be quite prophetic for you. Do you feel any particular affinity for it?
Oh, very much so.
Before you answer, I think you'd better explain the relevance, I think.
Well, the girl in that, I married at the end. It was the first film I'd been in where I got the girl in the end. And I thought, well, why not? And I married her, and that was 32 years ago. We've been happily married ever since. Rona Anderson.
Yeah.
Yes, it wasn't a great world-shaking film, but it was quite fun. It was quite a fascinating film because it was made out of pinewood with a new system. It was a brilliant idea called independent frame. Instead of building sets, they took photographs of houses and rooms, and you acted in front of these. It was a bit limiting from actors, but from an actor's point of view, but it was much cheaper, and it was a very good idea.
Quick.
Unfortunately, it fell through, and Rank lost a great deal of money out of it. I think mainly he fell through because he didn't get good, I say good directors, he didn't get high power directors on it, and he certainly didn't have very good scripts on it. Flood Tide was no great shakes as a script. So I think they rather judged it on that rather than the process. It was a very, very good idea.
I see. I remember in a more recent film, I remember you seeing you acting in The Great Escape.
Oh, yes.
Sir Richard Attenborough. He, of course, gone to produce The Bridge Too Far and Gandhi.
Yes.
Do you ever wish that you'd gone into production like he
did? No desire at all. Production, direction, no. I've often been given, not to direct in films, but in the theatre, people have asked me. In a strange sort of way, I'm not interested. You should only direct or produce if you're mad keen to do it. I mean, lots and lots of actors have become directors.
Yeah.
Lionel Jeffries, Brian Forbes, Richard Attenborough, masses of them. And they admit that too, they'd always wanted to direct. I have no desire to direct, no.
No. You've been in 60 or so films.
Have I really?
I'm afraid you have, yes. It's making you look awfully old. I'm sorry about that. Do you have any particular favourites amongst them?
None at all, because I hate being an actor. I don't really enjoy it. The only thing I can see as a favourite film is when I enjoy the crowd. That's the only fun I get out of acting, the people who are there, the unit. I'd miss that very much. That's why I wouldn't give it up. That's why I don't do anything else. I can't do anything else now. I've forgotten all the engineering draftsman stuff. But... No, I like actors, and I like technicians. So I look back fondly on certain film locations with a certain unit, if it all went well.
That's I think people don't realise though how much fun you can actually have with the people who are there with you.
Oh, it's very nice. It's a great atmosphere. Yeah. I love the atmosphere of a studio.
I suppose you could say you contributed to the heyday of the British film.
Well, I was lucky to be around, certainly at the beginning at Ealing Studios. Yeah. There were some smashing films made at that time. It was a marvellous little unit, Ealing Studios. Rather sort of egg-heady Cambridge and Oxford types, all sitting around writing the scripts and directing. But they were very, very good films. I was very lucky from that point of view, because I was under contract to them at the beginning. Just a peppercorn contract, nothing grand. But they would literally write in parts for me for the first few years. I was sort of protected. It was only when that contract came to an end and I found myself out in the cruel, hard world, I realised how lucky I'd been. The first script I got, I remember, after I'd left Ealing, I thought, I can't say this, I can't say that. And I realised then that they'd doctored every
line
for me.
All the scripts just for you. How do you feel the British film industry shaping up now then?
Well, it all seems very healthy with Chariots of Fire and Gandhi and all these Oscars waving. It's not so much how is the British film industry faring, how is the world film industry faring, because it's terrifying, the drop in attendance numbers in the cinema. So they've got this huge problem, no matter how wonderful the films they make, there are fewer cinemas and fewer people who want to go along. But apart from the British film industry, I went to see Tootsie the other night and I thought that was magic.
I'm waiting to see
I
that
really
myself,
thought
actually,
that was one of the finest films I'd ever seen. I was reminded of it last night because I saw Some Like It Hot for about the 20th time on television. And it's rather than that sort of genre. Yeah. Beautiful film, Tootsie, and a marvellous performance from Dustin Hoffman.
Do you admire him?
Oh, marvellous actor. Yeah. The marvellous thing about Dustin Hoffman, he goes out on a limb, being 100-year-old Indians with sort of leather masks in his face and things. He doesn't play it safe. I admire actors
who do
that.
Takes a lot of risks, doesn't he?
I hate myself for that, because I've always played it safe. You say I'm always reliable and the sidekick and things like that. I'd love to be a nasty and really be awful in a film. Actors who are awful in films are the exciting actors, because other times they can be brilliant. But I've always steered a sort of vague, sort of Scottish, even course. Yeah. And I don't like myself for that. I admire exciting actors who will go out on a limb.
I see. Right, moving on now from films to television.
Yes.
And a role which has brought you a great deal of success, that of Angus Hudson.
Oh, yes.
When you were offered the part, did you think that the series would be as successful as it was?
Oh, of course not. Nobody ever knows that. In fact, we made the first 13 episodes and they said, well, that's it, and it's been fascinating. We all went home. Yeah. And then a few months later, they didn't keep us under contract or anything. They rang up and said, look, we might do some more. And in fact, we did another 13, so they went on, and eventually we did 65. But always at the end of each series, they always said, when I say series, that's 13, they said, that's it, goodbye. And even when they showed the first lot of Upstairs, Downstairs, they only showed 6. They withheld 7 just to see how it went, so nobody knew how
it did well in the States as well, didn't it? I think it was surprising for that era.
Well, in a specialised way, actually, let's be honest, it was a PBS channel, which is rather a protected channel with no commercials, and a sort of Anglophile Americans watch it, people in Los Angeles, New York, oh, I love little old England. But I don't think they would have gone for it much in the Middle West.
Do you think that 65 episodes wasn't enough? Would you have liked it to carry on?
Oh, of course. Oh, I'm sort of, I'd be perfect for Coronation Street. I'd want to go on for 20 years. Because, as I say, I don't really enjoy acting. I have no ambitions as an actor. But once you get into a nice crowd, and especially they were very nice and upstairs, downstairs, I just wanted to go on forever, like a house party.
Do you think you'd make a good butler yourself?
Terrible. No, far too emotional. Actors wouldn't be good butlers. They'd be all right for a day or so, a day or so, but really to suppress your own personality and say yes or no, sir, when you really want to say you're being an idiot, sir. I think they're a marvellous butler, a good butler. I think it's wonderful. Well, it's like a good waiter.
Yeah. You obviously played it very well because you got the Emmy in 76 for the best
supporting actor. Oh, you have been looking up the books, haven't you? The nice thing about Emmys and things is it gives you fun at the time, but everybody else forgets and it doesn't matter. I mean, they always say, let's stop giving awards and things, but I think awards are good for the time because you get a lovely lunch and everybody claps for a minute and then you forget it. And you mustn't take it to heart and say I must be a good actor or anything like that. I was just lucky to be in a series that clicked. Yeah. I could have worked 10 times as hard on another series that didn't work and it would have made no impression at all. If you get into the framework of a series like Upstairs, Downstairs that sort of takes off, it can only do you all a lot of good.
Yeah.
But it's all a great gamble. You can never be sure if it's going to come off or not.
Yeah. In The Professionals, playing the part of Cowley, a lot of people here don't think this, but I think he has a lot of Hudson's characteristics.
Oh, completely. Well, shall we say, Hudson had a lot of Gordon Jackson, and everything is a lot of Gordon Jackson. Yeah. I can't put on funny noses and funny hats and pretend I'm somebody else.
But they can both be very gentle people and at the same time be very forceful.
I always say with Hudson had a silver salve and I just dropped and picked up a Tommy gun for... In fact, the part in The Professionals is much nearer the sort of things I used to do. He was a sort of army sergeant.
I noticed you made a lot of, you played a lot of soldier parts.
That's right.
Armed force parts in your films.
So that, in fact, is what, so the odd man out completely was Hudson, but he was a sort of gentle sergeant in a way, the Hudson character on Upstairs, Downstairs.
In charge.
Yeah.
It must be quite a difficult program to make, The Professionals, this is. Are there ever any accidents or anything like that?
Yes, insofar as, they do drive like mad, the boys, these cars, once they leap into them. Yeah. And of course, one's trying to outdo the other, being better than the other. And I'm Muggsy sitting at the side. So after the first few days, I said, would you get a double when you're going to drive that car, sitting beside Martin or Lewis? Because they're absolutely, they're apt to twirl the car around in the brake and all that sort of thing. And
they actually do that themselves, do they?
Oh, yes. Oh, lots of it they do themselves. Oh, they love it. They can hardly wait.
Imagine. when it first came out, Professionals, there were a lot of complaints about violence.
Oh, yes.
How do you feel about that?
Well, I would say that was an action-packed series. So with an action-packed series, you're bound to have collision. I don't think there was premeditated violence. It was good, healthy fisticuffs.
Yes, personally, I liked it very much.
Yes.
It's a very good program.
Well, you see, they first said about violence, they gave it rotten notices at the start. Even Brian Clements admit that, who wrote the series. It wasn't until a little about the second or the third series people started warming up to it.
Yeah.
But we were attacked, especially one man, Richard Afton, I think he was, a man in the evening news. He could hardly wait to get his teeth into The Professionals every week. And even after it started soaring to the top of ratings, he kept saying, stop looking at this, it's terrible. Yeah. You must realise this is awful. Fortunately, he's retired now.
a couple of years ago, also, the professional. There was some talk of making Professionals film. Are you sorry that it never came
out? Well, they always talk about that. They thought of making an Upstairs Downstairs film. It's a great gamble, again, because lots of television series spin-offs for films. Some have been successful, some have not been successful. Yeah. And especially Upstairs Downstairs and The Professionals. Once you get into in The Professionals, you're getting into James Bond land. Therefore, you'd have to spend a great deal of money. So you're gambling on people saying, oh, I could see this for nothing at home. Why should I go and pay for it in the cinema? In fact, that's why The Professionals came to an end. It became too expensive to make, they said, because of this James Bond thing with helicopters and speedboats and all that sort of thing. It was too expensive per episode, which is sad.
Oh, are we unlikely to see any more Professionals again then?
I doubt it, not only from the finance point of view, but I think it would be very difficult getting the boys together again because in the right way, and they're young and they want to go on to other things. They should do. The Professionals made them pretty famous. Very famous,
very
in fact.
Famous.
So Lewis has gone on to do his films, Who Dare Wins, and Martin's gone back to his first love, the theatre. And they're very busy all around the world doing things. I think it would be very difficult
well,
getting them back
they?
Again.
Martin certainly had very good reviews in the theatre.
Oh, he's a marvellous actor. Oh, he always was a marvellous actor. But he was a classical actor before he went into The Professionals. Yeah. I don't think he enjoyed it as much as he should. I think he rather resented it eventually being held down in a series. I think the thing to do is once you sign a contract for a series and you can't break it, the thing to do is try and enjoy it. I don't think he enjoyed it as much as he should have.
That didn't really come across on the screen, though.
No.
They both seem to be.
Oh, because they're very professional actors. And I mean, it's not as if they were moaning and things all the time, but I always felt they were a bit unhappy and were relieved when it was over.
Yeah.
And I, in fact, was very sad when it was all over.
Oh, I'd thought so. There are two completely different types of programmes, Upstairs, Downstairs and The Professionals.
Yeah.
What sort of things do you actually enjoy watching on television?
What do I enjoy watching? Oh, I suppose all the usual dreary things, the sort of news programmes and nature programmes. Old movies, I love them, old movies. That's why I'm mad about Channel 4. I don't watch drama very much. I think it gives me an inferiority complex because everyone's being so good. And I keep thinking, how do they remember all those lines? I find it increasingly difficult learning lines.
That's something I'm amazed about.
So it really worries me. No, I watch Coronation Street because I think they're magic. I mean, I can't say I don't miss some episodes. Of course I do, but I think they're terribly funny and I love seeing something as polished as that, so beautifully done.
Coming to that thing about remembering lines, you can't be too bad yourself. You've done a lot of stage work.
Oh, yes.
You've done Hamlet, Macbeth, Twelfth Night, Shakespeare plays.
I hasten to add that I wasn't playing Hamlet, Macbeth. I was just being sidekicks there. I was just playing Horatio in Hamlet and Banquo in Macbeth.
Well, recently then, in Cards on the Table and Death Trap, Mass Appeal, you played
Top my head off. Top my head off, and it was very difficult to learn, I can tell you. It gets more difficult, increasingly difficult, as you get older.
Yeah.
I couldn't sit an exam now. I couldn't remember everything. It would be very difficult.
I don't think I could either.
But it was very difficult. They're doing an awful thing now, you see, which it sounds as if I'm getting old, but it is a bit worrying. Nowadays, they don't seem to do the script that is given to you. In the old days, you were given a script, you learned your lines, and that was it. Nowadays, they all seem to be changing all the time. They have no confidence in the material they have, which I think is very wrong. No matter what script I do, having accepted it, I think this is King Lear, every word is absolutely sacrosanct, and we must stick to the script. But the professionals, for instance, they were changing here, there, and everywhere. The boys used to change their lines, and they were marvellous at it, but I said, no matter what, just give me the cue and I'll say what I have learned, because it's taken me 3 weeks to learn it. They could learn it in the morning just looking at it before they go on the set.
You've appeared with people like Sir Alec Guinness, Michael Caine, Kirk Douglas. And here comes the standard interview question. Is there anybody else you'd particularly like to work with in the future?
Not particularly, but it's funny you should mention those names. Great name dropping going on. In the sort of parts I play, as I'm a sidekick, as I'm around, I've been around with lots of great actors. Yeah. Where I say I don't enjoy acting, that's one of the joys I get, watching these people tick, because they are fascinating. They have a God-given quality. Even if you worked from now until doomsday, you could never be an actor like a Brand or an Alec Guinness or a Gielgud. Yeah. They just have this wonderful thing. And it's marvellous as an actor to stand on the sidelines and watching them working. It's very, very exciting.
You've been quoted as saying that your unfulfilled ambition is to be an actor, not acting the real thing.
That I don't understand. I heard that.
I didn't understand it either.
I don't understand it either. I think they got it wrong. Oh. I remember someone told me about that. I don't know what they're talking about. I just want to carry on being an actor. I want to be as honest as I can. But I want to be entertaining too. Some people are so busy being honest as actors, they're terribly dreary, because life can be very dreary. That's the extra quality in acting. You've got to rise above reality and bring entertainment to it. Never lose sight of entertainment.
Do you feel being Scottish has hindered your chance of getting certain roles in the past?
Tremendously, yes. Not that I'd be angry at you, of course I could have worked very early getting an English accent, but I never have done. Yes, it has. Actually, later when sort of Peter O'Toole and Albert Finney came down with regional accents and played leading Shakespearean role with these accents, that helped a lot. In the old days when I first started, unless it literally stipulated in the script, enter Angus McSporran, you would never be considered. Yeah. But nowadays they say, enter John Smith, he might be Scots. Of course, there are lots more parts than that. But I think it has rather blinkered me, the Scots thing, I must admit.
You've done rather well out of it anyway, I think.
Well, I've kept ticking, we've survived, that's the thing. I think there are so many variations on a Scottish theme. That's what I cling to, and that's what I keep working at.
Finally, do you have any plans for next year?
None at all. Just to sit, actually. I enjoy sitting. No, not particularly. I get odd scripts and things. I've been having a rest for the last 2 or 3 months, and I've been rather enjoying it. Because, as I say, this line learning thing, I did 3 stage plays in a row, and I worked far too hard. Yeah. And I suddenly thought, let's breathe, look around a bit. So I've been out in Australia, and I've been over in Spain, and I've been enjoying it. Oh, I suppose eventually we'll have to start paying the rent again, and I'll work and work. But we'll see what happens. I'd like to go back and to do a film again. I haven't been in films for quite a long time, because I don't belong to the nouvelle vague sort of thing. But it would be nice, because films are my favourite medium. They really are. For a start, you don't have to learn just so many lines for each day.
Yes.
They rather spoil you. And I think when it works, a film scene, it's tremendously exciting. I mean, there are off nights in the theatre where you think, oh, it'd maybe be better tomorrow night. But the idea of a scene with, say, someone like Brando or Tracy that really works, no matter if it's a wet afternoon in Scunthorpe, that is still up there on the screen, and it's still as marvellous. I think that's very exciting quality about the cinema.
Well, I certainly hope to see more of you in the coming years. Gordon Jackson, thank you very much for coming.
Thank you, Donald. Thank you.